Thank you, madam. So now I invite Dr. Surya Gupta to speak on publishing your work. Essentially, I have requested him to amalgamate all the talks that we have given now, summarize them, and put his own punches.
Thank you, Dr. Sen Gupta, for allowing me to be a part of your wonderful IC. Now, my previous speakers have basically told you everything you need to know about what and how to write a good paper and how to publish it. Writing is not enough. You need to publish your work. Now, let me just amalgamate everything and just concise everything what has been spoken by my previous speakers for you easy remembrance. Now, the major challenge is to start. Now, why do you need to publish a paper? Firstly, you need to share your inventions and your discoveries with the rest of the people. You can present in podiums, but they'll be forgotten in a year. If you publish it, they'll be available for citations for the rest of your life. Secondly, if you're a junior doctor, it's your fundamental duty to publish for you to progress in your clinical career. And thirdly, it is your, you can say clinical evolution, the next stage in your clinical evolution is to publish a paper. So once you have decided to publish a paper, then what my previous speakers have said, you need to get all these in a coherent order. You cannot have randomly, you find out, just plan a little, what is your target audience, which paper you want to publish, which will be the direction of your work. Once you have done that, the first step you need to do is get hold of a mentor, a person who have already published a lot of papers. This is the person who is going to help you to guide your rocket in whichever direction you want it to go. He'll tell you this is a good topic, this is a bad topic. That person will be responsible for overviewing all your progress and development. Now, after you've got a mentor and you've got some sort of working title, you need to create a timetable. This is very important. Otherwise, your paper will become Birbal ka khichdi. It'll go on forever and ever. You'll never finish it. So create a timetable for literature review and template. A basic title, at what time your first draft will be finished, you'll complete all your revisions, your co-authors and co-author workers will suggest changes and additions, figures and abstracts, and then last of all, proof all changes with the mentor and send it out. So you'll have a timetable for this. Keep a month for literature search, a week for basic title, give your co-authors at least a week to go through your paper and give you suggestions. Don't keep on working it on your paper for an infinite amount of time. Now, after you've done that, Dr. Paul has very efficiently told you what to write and under which topics to write. So basically, a paper has 18 paragraphs. Now, these paragraphs are scaffoldings, actually. These are not exact. You should have 18 or 19 or 17, but these are basic scaffoldings on which you can build your paper, how to write your paper. You have done everything, you've got all your research, you have done the statistics, now you need to write the paper. So the first topic, as she has said, it's introduction. Now in the first paragraph of introduction, you should carry most of the words of your title. At least some of the title words from your title should be there in the first para. Get the readers interested within the first three sentences of your first paragraph. Otherwise, the reader will get bored, the reviewer will get bored. The second paragraph should state why your paper is needed. Is it the next logical step from the previous papers, or does it contradict previous papers? Quote 2 to 3 journals. Don't quote the journals by name. State your fact, then reference the journals by numbers at the end of the index. Nobody likes to read the names in the middle of a paragraph. The third paragraph should, you know, carry over from the second para and state the overarching reason why you need to have this study done or why this paper was needed. The last line should be the purpose of the study is. This should be the last line of introduction. Now, the readers will get intrigued, on what is the content of the paper, what is the content of the study. So this is your introduction. After introduction, you have, as she said, materials and method. Now, if you have a large material and method section, you can break it down into subsections. So again, the first para is the subjects. Now, is it a cohort study? Is it a case control study? Is it a retrospective study? Is it a prospective study? What are your inclusion exclusion criteria? Your board consent, your informed patient consent should be there in this first para. The second paragraph is procedures and techniques. How you have done it, what are the exact steps? It should be well documented so that, you know, it is reproducible by the readers. It should be easy. Exact steps should be given. Mention the name of companies, which instruments you have used. They might be deleted later on due to advertisement and other advertorial issues, but you should mention the name of the exact instruments used. The third para should be definitions and criteria. Don't assume the reader knows everything. You might have a particular definition, you need to clarify it. Suppose you are writing a paper on a lack of symptom is a confirmation of a disease. So you need to state how long you have waited for that lack of symptom to be there. If there's a level of severity, you have to mention what is the level of severity. Don't assume everybody knows everything. Criteria, criteria, criteria. Remember, it's very important. The next para, he has said data collection. How did you validate your data? What is your gold standard? How did you take care of the intra and the inter observer variability? This should come in this paragraph. And the last is statistical tests. Now, first, initially, you should put a general statistics about the general population and then go into specific statistics, and the last line should be p-value. Remember, the p-value is the strength of your results. It is not the strength of your clinical importance. You should remember that. So after materials and methods, you have results. The results paragraph order should follow what you have written in the materials and method. That way it'll be easy. So in the first, it should be a descriptive statistics regarding your population. What is the age, sex, demography of the population? What is the standard deviation? What is the mean of your study? Now, you should make the reader, first of all, compare whether the groups are comparable within themselves, and secondly, whether their patient pool is comparable to your patient pool. You should let the readers decide this. In the second paragraph, you should get your results. Make sure the values are correct. Don't turn centimeters into millimeters and grams into milligrams or kilograms. This is very important. Don't editorialize your results. State them as you have gotten it. Then in third para, how did you measure the validity again? What are your guidelines for the factors which influence your data? How have you taken care of the factors which are controllable versus uncontrollable factors? So this should come in this para. The last is statistical analysis, which I know very little of, but Dr. Sengupta has talked so clearly about. So after that, you get discussion. Now in discussion, the first paragraph should be your chief results. Don't go into major facts of your studies. Just state the principle, as she has mentioned. State the principle fact of your study, findings, and conclusion of your study. The second paragraph is how you interpret your results, whether it shows broader the light on some broad issue, whether it is shows some specific inferences. This should come in your second para of discussion. In the third para, how does it compare with the previous studies? Does it contradict? Does it supplement? How does it contradict? Does it add any new value to the current literature concept? This should come in your third para. In the fourth para, again, what are the clinical implications? Are there any diagnostic pitfalls? Does it contradict any other diagnostic or clinical symptoms we have encountered before? In the 17th para, what are the limitations of your study? It is very important to let the reader know the limitations of your study. Don't overly criticize your study. You have worked very hard to print and write this study. Mention the limitations, but don't go overboard with it. Otherwise, the reviewer would not have to work very hard to reject your paper. The last is summary and directions, which can be also broken down into conclusion. The first line should be the purpose of the study was to this, and we found this. And last line should always be, so the next logical step, if there is a logical step, the next logical step of this study would be, so that you know you give a continuation for future readers to go on with this study, or you declare that this is the end, there is no future in this line of investigation, and we should not investigate anymore on this line of progress. Now, what is a good enough paper? Firstly, to write a very good paper, you need to do revisions. As ma'am has very nicely said, this is not your English essay. So you have written a very good rhetorical lines with quoting from quotes from very good English authors, but you have to get above all that. go through piece by piece. Don't go through the whole article at the same time. Review one piece, review method section initially, sleep over it at night, and then again in the morning, again go over it again. So go through piecemeal. Don't go throughout the whole paper in one review session. Make changes, sleep on it, look at it the next day, you'll get a better perspective. See, by the third or fourth draft, you should be about 75% complete on your paper. Now, once you have reached this stage, stop. You have done enough, now pass it on to your co-authors and co-workers. Whenever I have a out-of-the-box presentation, I always ask a non-medical person to review my presentation. It gives me various insights which I've never thought of. So pass it on to your co-workers, incorporate their suggestions. You don't have to take everything into consideration. You can delete whatever you want, but it's very important you get their perspective also. So once you have done that, then comes the question of authorship. The first author is the person who, you are the first author. You have written this paper. You have worked very hard. The last author is your mentor. Everybody in the middle are the ones who have helped you or you're obligated to include their name. It's very well known that there are a lot of ghost authors or there are a lot of the authors who have not worked done anything for your paper, but then again, as an obligation, you have to include their names. Now in the final draft, as everybody has said, persuasive expressions through well-expressed sentences. Force yourself, it might be very boring, you might have read your paper 10 times, but the last thing is very important. Force yourself to go through one last reading. Make sure all the numbers add up. You don't want to find a lot of mistakes in your calculations. The values are not correct. Your units are not matching up. Make sure no major misspellings are there. Correct the references order which you have put at the end. But do not strive for perfection. If you strive for perfection, you'll never finish your paper in time. Now then you have to choose your journal. There are low impact, high value. So which journal do you choose? What is your target audience? Your mentor will guide you. You will have a basic idea. Is it a general or a subspecialty paper? That will also help you in choosing which paper you want to submit it to. Do not undervalue or overvalue a paper. You know, you might lose out on opportunities. When a reviewer sends change, please change this or please change that. You don't have to change everything, but at least appear to change a lot of things. You know, a positive attitude from you will get a positive attitude from the reviewer. If you start quibbling about even the minor of the changes, the reviewer will not be happy and it's not going to be a very healthy process for your paper to get published. Everybody has to deal with rejection. If you are rejected, submit in a reformat and submit in another paper. There are other journals you can submit it into. Modify it according to the critical response given by your reviewers. They can help you to be a stepping step for your paper. Analyze your paper for self-analysis for a better paper next time. No reviewer wants to work hard. Remember that. So these are the three journals or papers you can do if you're really interested. They have given an excellent oversight on how to write a paper or how to write a clinical publishing paper. And I have found that they have covered almost all the topics and all the queries you might have. So these are the three papers. They are very helpful. From 1990 to 2004, basically the basic outline of this publishing paper has not changed a lot. So I thank you, and like my chief instructor, I invite you to AIOC21 in Calcutta. I believe the early bird registration is also valid for today. I think so, yeah. So you can avail a huge discount around 1500 from the early bird.